Good morning. Good morning and welcome to First Unitarian Universalist Church of Nashville. My name is Jaie Tiefenbrunn. I am pleased to be your Director of Music Ministries, and my pronouns are she, her. It's my pleasure to welcome you to online worship this morning, and you know, sometimes there are technical difficulties. Our collaborative pianist today is Holling Smith Bourne. If you're watching live, buttons will appear that will bring you to our website. If you're watching on YouTube or Facebook, you can visit us at firstuunash.org and click on the With You Worship Portal button for all the information you need for today's worship, including the order of service, a link to our joys and concerns, and to our offering. Please join in singing our responsive hymn this morning, number 1037, We Begin Again in Love.
For remaining silent, when a single voice would have made a difference.
We forgive ourselves and each other. We begin again in love.
For each time that our fears have made us rigid and inaccessible.
We forgive ourselves and each other. We begin again in love.
For each time we have struck out in anger without just cause.
We
each time that our greed has blinded us to the needs of others.
We forgive ourselves and each other. We begin again in love.
For the selfishness that sets us apart and alone. Falling short of the admonitions of the Spirit.
We forgive ourselves and each other. We begin again in love.
For losing sight of our unity. For these and for so many acts, both evident and subtle, which have fueled the illusion of our separateness.
We forgive ourselves and each other. We begin again in love.
I invite you now to take a breath and connect into your heart space and expand your awareness out to include our neighbors worshiping online with us. Won't you say hello in the chat to let us know that you're here? Good morning.
Good morning. I'm Gail Spar, and I'm a member of the Worship Committee. The words for our chalice lighting this morning were written by Lisa Doge. Why a chalice? The question comes. It's the cup of life, we answer. A cup of blessings overflowing. A cup of water to quench our spirit's thirst. A cup of wine for celebration and dedication. The flame of truth, the fire of purification. Oil for anointing, healing. Out of chaos, fear, and horror, thus was the symbol crafted a generation ago. So may it be for us in these days of uncertainty, sorrow, and rage, and a light to warm our souls and guide us home.
Good morning. I'm the Reverend Diane Dowgiert, your developmental lead minister. The words for our call to worship this morning were written by Patrick Murfin. We believe that many streams join to make a river, that the way of wisdom lies in an open ear and heart, that goodness may be pursued for the sake of goodness, and not from fear of punishment, that knowing and not knowing are part of the same, and ambiguity is possible. In this spirit we gather, come, let us worship.
Thank you.
Today's story is titled Arjuna's Service to His People. The story comes to us from the Hindu tradition. It raises some questions about choosing the right thing to do and how that choice isn't always clear. A long, long time ago in India, there was a king who had two sons. When the king died, older brother was entitled to inherit the entire kingdom. Younger brother was jealous. Older brother graciously divided the kingdom in half and shared it, but younger brother was still not satisfied. He stole the whole kingdom for himself and his children. He refused to share the land with older brother, unless there was a war. Older brother and his children did not want to fight, but they had only two choices: to fight for their rights or turn away from war and their rightful land to preserve peace and nonviolence. One of older brother's children was Arjuna, a famous warrior. He had a special relationship with the god Krishna, the god of all gods. Krishna called Arjuna to lead the battle. Of course, Arjuna dutifully came to the battlefield to obey. He had led many battles successfully for Krishna before. But Arjuna was shocked to see who was getting ready for war on the other side. The people who were called his enemies were, in fact, his own family. Not only his uncle, younger brother, but also Arjuna's cousins, some of his uncles, his favorite teachers, and very dear friends. He did not want to kill them and was very confused that Krishna, the god of all gods, had called him to lead this war. He was especially confused since Krishna had always said, the most important thing for a good person to do is to avoid harming any living thing. As a warrior, Arjuna's duty sometimes required him to kill. That was hard. But this time it was an even harder problem. Arjuna argued and argued with Krishna because he wanted to be a good person. He wanted to do his duty, yet he could not stand the thought of doing violence against relatives and friends. Krishna told Arjuna many stories to persuade Arjuna to do his duty as a warrior. In one story, there was a hermit who lived in the woods who always told the truth. One day, an evil robber chased a merchant into the woods. The robber asked the hermit if he knew where the merchant was hiding. Because he always told the truth, the hermit pointed and said, "Yes, I saw him going that way," causing the merchant to die. Krishna said, "If there is a choice between two good behaviors, for example, telling the truth because it is right, or lying to prevent someone from being killed, some good behaviors are better than others. In this case, wouldn't it have been better for the hermit to lie and protect the life of the merchant?" In another story, Krishna told Arjuna about a farming couple who worried about the weather, their seeds, and their tools, worried that they would not be good enough to create a good crop to feed the family. Because of their worries, the farmers decided not to work their land at all, in the same way that Arjuna was refusing to fight the war. But Krishna said the best thing a person can do is their duty, to the best of their ability, without worrying about the results. A farmer or a warrior should not worry about the outcome. To work is their duty, and they must do their best. The farmers and their family would have nothing if they did not work at all. Well, Arjuna was still not convinced that leading the battle was the right thing to do. He was pretty sure that if he did his duty well, he would hurt people he cared about. He still did not want to do it. Then Krishna had one more argument to convince Arjuna. He asked Arjuna to think about his father, old brother, and the rest of Arjuna's family members who had been wronged. Hadn't their land been stolen? Were they not also his brothers and sisters, cousins, siblings, and dear friends who needed Arjuna to fight and help them get their land back? Krishna said that fighting for your rights is an important duty. Krishna told Arjuna, the best way to be a good person is to do your duty. See the goodness in all living beings. Treat all beings equally and do good things for others. In these ways, Arjuna could be happy and have a closer relationship with Krishna. Arjuna wanted to be happy and stay close with Krishna, the God of all gods. Yet he did not see how he could do all these things at once, not this time. And so ends our story for today.
Good morning. My name is Denise Gouch. My pronouns are she and her. I am your assistant minister, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to worship. As Unitarian Universalists, our spiritual paths vary, but in this congregation, we have made a covenant together. We affirm our interdependence, celebrate our differences, and work for justice. We are a welcoming congregation, and we deepen our relationships as we serve our congregation's mission to create community, nurture spiritual growth, and act on our values in the broader world, guided by reason and compassion. I'd like to extend a special welcome to visitors worshiping with us. If you are seeking a spiritual home, we hope that you may find it here. All are welcome to attend our services, and people become members of this congregation by signing the membership book and supporting the church with their time and finances. If you are considering joining the church or just would like to know more about us, please contact me, the Assistant Minister for Congregational Engagement. You can find my email address in the staff directory under Contact Us on our website, and I would love to hear from you. Following the service, we hope everyone will enjoy at least one of the online opportunities for fellowship listed in our online worship portal, and our website holds many other announcements of interest, which I hope you will read. You may know that we share every Sunday's collection with an organization whose work outside our walls aligns with our values. For the month of September, our Share the Plate partner is our Share the Plate social justice team. You can find more about their work in our online worship portal. And today...
Good morning. My name is Amanda Fernandez. I'm with Room in the Inn. For those of you who don't know, Room in the Inn is an agency that provides care for individuals experiencing homelessness throughout the year. You might be familiar with our winter shelter program. This program, in partnership with approximately 200 congregations in our area, works to provide shelter and safety during the coldest months here in Nashville, November until March. This program, along with the commitment of your volunteers, provides a respite from the streets. It allows people to step out of the crowd and into your building as an individual. This care and hospitality cannot be replicated. That is why we plan to continue forward with our winter shelter program this season. With precautions in place, of course, we plan to kick off on November 1st, and it is our hope that you will be able to host guests inside of your building. We know that this is a lot. It will require additional planning, the commitment of your entire community, as well as a time of discernment. We are here to support you. We are here to support you in ways that you have always supported us. Room in the Inn has not closed its doors a single day during this pandemic. This is in part to planning, adjustment, sound advice, but could not have succeeded without the willingness of our participants to work to create an environment that is safe for all who enter. Whether it's wearing masks and social distancing, or it's coming each morning to a completely new set of protocols. They have ridden this wave with us, and it is because of them that we are safe and our doors are still open. Please know that all you have done has been a gift to our community, and we are grateful. We are becoming exceedingly more aware of what it means to host and to invite our community into your own and to make us one. And for that, we are grateful. Thank you.
We are aware that many of you may not have been able to hear that video. If you're interested in hearing about Room in the Inn, their work is so wonderful, but you can check the feed on YouTube or Facebook later today to hear that. For now, we don't have the pleasure of passing physical offering bowls to each other, but our finance folks have made sure that anyone, anytime, can give by way of our online donation form at firstuunash.org. If you would like to mail a check to the church, please write in the memo line how you would like your donation to be used. If you want your gift to be credited to your pledge, please write pledge. If you write Sunday offering, it will be donated to our Share the Plate partner. In this season of virtual offering bowls, we are especially grateful for the steady generosity which allows us both within and beyond the congregation to continue creating community, nurturing spiritual growth, and acting on our values. We are also deeply, deeply grateful for your presence with us. And I invite you now to join in our weekly ritual of gathered community. Following the upcoming musical interlude, we will share the joys and concerns submitted through the online form, provided permission has been given on that form. All joys and concerns will be shared as usual with our lay ministry team. Now take a moment and just be in the space that you are in right now, and know that you have both made this, the space you inhabit, holy simply by being there, and also that you are connected across time and space with the rest of us who are here celebrating together that we are a community. And to that community, we each bring all that we are, and we bring from the days and the hours before this one, the joys, the sorrows, the worries, the concerns that we all hold in ourselves and within our families and households and in this world. Thank you. We have a joy this morning from Hudson. He says, this is a joy that my 13th birthday is this week. Happy birthday, Hudson. Welcome to the teenage years. And I have a joy from Anne Morse. Remembering warmly my grandfather, Frank Berend, who was born 123 years ago yesterday and today. That's a long story, but typical for him. So holding these joys and these happy memories, a grandfather, as well as all the other bright and beautiful things in our lives this morning, and also the things that we carry with slightly heavier hearts. And I know that we all have those in this season. Let us join together in a spirit of prayer. Spirit of life and love, we are grateful this morning for this community with which we gather. We are grateful to have a place where we can bring our celebrations, where we can bring our memories, where we together build new memories, create new connections, learn better how to be with each other. It's where we provide comfort, where we educate each other, where we share and strengthen each other as we move out together into the world to make the choices that are difficult, to know that as we make those choices and move through our lives, we have each other always to return to again and again, to begin again and again, to move together through the world. May we always be so. Amen. Blessed be.
Good morning. My name is Rachel Rogers. My pronouns are she and her. I'm a member of this congregation and I'm serving as the worship associate for today's service. I recently looked back at my Twitter timeline and saw something I'd posted back in January about how I'd slipped and fallen in a Whole Foods, totally wiping out, before accidentally knocking an entire basket of chips over a pizza counter in the same store something like 3 minutes later. I added the hashtag 2020 when I posted it back then, but I reposted it last week with a comment that I had no idea what 2020 energy truly was back in January. The path that 2020 would take was unimaginable. As the pandemic has settled in, hidden us in our homes, dispersed our gatherings, and canceled our plans, our day-to-day experiences have become infinitely complicated and wrought with new questions to be answered. Entering the world is easy enough, but then you're working to maintain a 6-foot space between you and someone else, and also trying to keep your mask from slipping down or dealing with your glasses fogging up. Or maybe you're at home and you're desperate for help, or just to see a beloved member of your family who doesn't live with you. You're now deciding what questions you need to ask them about what they've been doing and where they've been to make sure they're taking whatever steps you have settled on that make the decision to see them safe for you. And how uncomfortable and painful and even angering it is when that beloved person you miss so much has been making choices that don't quite make the cut of what you may have deemed responsible. And it's just so frustrating that everyone seems to have a different set of rules. Did you ever imagine the tangled layer upon layer of complications and choices we'd be regularly facing? Or the fact that no two households, let alone people, are making the exact same choices? I have yet to meet two people who are on the exact same page. And it hurts. It hurts when someone isn't doing the things you think they should. You're worried about them and you're confused by them. And then you question yourself. Are you being too hard on them? Are you being too strict? Friends, I have been so angry. I've been hurt and confused and frustrated. And to be honest, sometimes righteous anger often feels so much better than hopelessness. So I suppose what I'm trying to get to here for myself and for all of us is that we need to find a way to have compassion around other people's choices, to hold space for their reasoning. We have never, ever, ever had to make such high risk decisions day in and out for months on end, let alone with so much confusing information. It's exhausting. We are all exhausted. So I'm now going to do something that I cannot believe it has taken me 4 years to do in a reflection or a homily, and I'm going to make a Hamilton reference. I've had these painful feelings around forgiveness and these choices in the pandemic bouncing around in my heart for months. But when it came time to compose them and share them with you, I thought of the word that's the theme for this month's services, forgiveness. And immediately after, I thought of the song, It's Quiet Uptown from Hamilton, which I've listened to 100 times and have sobbed through multiple times. Every time I hear it, I'm struck by the brilliance it contains. It weaves such complicated and painful experiences, the loss of a child and the reconciliation of broken trust, into a beautiful moment of resilience and forgiveness. In the lyric, we hear the words, there are moments that the words don't reach. There's a grace too powerful to name. We push away what we can never understand. We push away the unimaginable. In watching the song performed, we see two grieving parents come back together to help each other move into the future. We watch two people navigating a set of pain and circumstances they never could have put into words before now. And they take each other's hand, and we hear the words, forgiveness. Can you imagine? The song is heartbreaking. And wow, did it feel relevant to our lives right now? Because right now, my beloveds, we are all trying to do the unimaginable. We're all navigating loss and fear and worry, and we are all, I genuinely believe, we're doing our best. So what does it take for us to forgive others right now who are making choices that concern you? I believe it takes courage, for one. Courage to ask questions about their choices and express your concern and risk the uncomfortable moment when you tell them why you disagree. It takes courage and a commitment to seek to understand, and to seek to understand, it takes imagination. If this year has taught us anything, it's that there are so many things within the realm of possibility that we have not thought of yet. So I'm trying to imagine what it could look like to focus on positive intent and to conceive of the complex decisions that resulted in the choices that others are making, to pause and honor the struggle and the complexities contained in one another's lives. I'll ask now that we move into a few moments together, joined in the spirit of silence. And as we're doing this, I ask you to consider opening your heart and creating space to hold those complexities, those struggles, those factors and complications that each of our lives are holding. Those things that if we knew, if we could imagine, would open the space for forgiveness. May it be so.
Please join Sarah and Laura of the duo Unfolding who have graciously shared their music with us for hymn number 1002, Comfort Me.
All our lives, we are making choices. From what we eat for breakfast to when we go to bed, we are constantly choosing one option over another. Some choices are made unconsciously by force of habit. Others we have to think about and weigh the alternatives carefully. Whether by habit or conscious decision, all choices have consequences. Some are large and some are small. We can't always know for sure what the outcome will be. Not only that, not all options are open to everyone. By circumstance of birth, some options are either less open or closed by things like size or ability, by gender or skin color, by the wealth or lack of wealth of the families that we are born into. All our lives we are making choices, but the choices we are faced with today were unimaginable 6 months ago. To go to the grocery store or not, to go to the hairdresser or not, to have physically distanced social gatherings with friends and family or not, to travel or not, to send our children to in-person school or not, to hold in-person church activities or not. The list goes on. So many choices with so many potentially large consequences. When the choices facing us have been politicized, as they have, it's hard to know who to trust, what advice to follow, and where to turn for guidance. For me, I've chosen to be cautious, following the numbers and the science, keeping my possible exposure to the coronavirus to a minimum. I do so not only to protect myself, but to protect those I live with and those who depend on me. I realize that my choices come with a certain amount of privilege. I can do my home or from this building that is spacious enough for more than adequate distance between coworkers. I can work remotely because I have the equipment and at least the minimal skills required to do so. More importantly, my employer, this church, you, allow me to do so. For this, I am grateful. Not everyone has the ability to work remotely. People whose work requires being physically present have to make a choice of continuing to work or not, which may mean a choice between working and being able to put meals on the table and keep a roof overhead. For some, the choice of sending their children to in-person school or not means a choice between being able to work or not. Like Arjuna in our story this morning, we are faced with decisions that are hard to reckon with, hard to reconcile one good versus another. Each of us will come to different conclusions based on our own circumstances. I am grateful for leaders of this congregation who have decided to suspend in-person activities for now, except under carefully considered and carefully controlled circumstances, like considering the possibility of opening for a room at the inn with carefully considered controls in place. I know there are ministers and pastors in other denominations who are feeling pressure from their congregations or denominational leaders, or both, to continue performing in-person weddings, baptisms, funeral services, and even serving communion at an in-person worship service. I'm grateful that I'm not faced with the choice to comply with such pressures or not. Grateful I don't have to make that decision. I am further grateful that this congregation is equipped with the technology, with the minimal technology, and a staff and worship associates who have at least the minimal skills to provide online worship and other ways of connecting during the week, imperfect as it may be. It helps too that many of your members have access to the internet and a device that will connect to it. I don't want to assume this is true of all or even most members. I know that for congregations of many faith traditions serving poor and historically marginalized communities, online services are much more challenging or even impossible due to lack of access to technology. My challenge to members of this congregation and to those visitors and friends who may be joining us today or watching us on Facebook or YouTube, my challenge to you is this. Take a moment to think about who you have missed seeing lately, especially those who may not be technically connected. And because they're disconnected, they're also lonely. then consider how you might reach out to them. Maybe an old-fashioned phone call, or an old-fashioned note, or card in the mail, or an old-fashioned gift left on their porch. All our lives, we are making choices. All choices have consequences. The choices we are facing today were unimaginable 6 months ago. Choices with unimaginable consequences. Choices that aren't always clear or easy. Truth is that sometimes we can make the best choice possible and still be overcome by illnesses, accidents, or natural disasters. Yet, with all the choices, there is always a reckoning, be it on the bank statement, in the doctor's office, or on the therapist's couch, or with the Almighty. There comes a time when we count the costs or reap the benefits of choices we've made. A time when we assess the impact the choices that we've made have on our lives and the lives of others. A time when we assess the impact choices made by others have had on us. When the choices we make upset or harm another person, or when our choices result in harm to ourselves, or when the choices of others have negative impacts on our lives, we are faced with yet another decision: to forgive or not. Or more accurately, the choice is to be willing to forgive. To be willing to forgive is to forego the path lined with anger, resentment, bitterness, and thoughts of revenge, and choose instead the path of courage and compassion. While the one path may lead to feelings of self-righteousness, the harder of the two is the path to forgiveness, a path that, if faithfully followed, can ultimately lead to more freedom, more ease, more peace of mind, and more joy. Forgiveness is a huge topic, one that we will be exploring throughout the month of September. On the coming Sundays, we will be looking more closely at self-forgiveness, forgiveness of others, and the collective work of forgiveness at this time of societal reckoning of the impact of our past choices. We'll be talking about what forgiveness is, what it is not, and how we might achieve it. Our hope is to provide you with some useful tools and spiritual comfort during these challenging times. The former Archbishop of South Africa, Desmond Tutu, held that there is no future without forgiveness. I hope you will tune in during the month of September as we undertake this important work together. In this time of unimaginable choices with unimaginable consequences, may all of our reckoning lead us to be willing to forgive. May it be so. May we make it so through our living.
I invite you to take a breath and come into your body to join in singing number 1015, I Know I Can.
Thank you.
words to our chalice extinguishing were written by Elizabeth Sell Jones, and they're at the bottom of your order of service. Please join me. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
May peace surround you as you go. May love light every step. May the spirit of this community abide within your soul. This service has ended. May our service continue renewed.